founder and CEO of Lux & Nix, and Luke Babbage, co-founder and CEO of Clever Real Estate.
Good evening, good evening. Welcome. As you're taking a seat, Lisa and I want to welcome you to the Arch Grants 10X event. As the VOG just said, I'm Luke Babbage, co-founder and CEO of Clever Real Estate from the Arch Grants class of 2018. I'm here tonight with my co-host.
Hello, everyone. I'm Lisa Hu, founder of Lux & Nix, Arch Grants class of 2019. And we are your MCs tonight for the Arch Grants 10X event, and we'll be running up and down the stage tonight all through the night. So good to see everyone here tonight.
Welcome, welcome. Please take a second, find your seats, wrap up that last conversation.
Get your last drink in.
Not your last drink, maybe your first.
Okay, fine, first.
First, second, third, somewhere between the first and the last. Thank you all so much. As you're finding your seats, Lisa and I are gonna kick off tonight's event by welcoming to the stage one of the two masterminds behind the evening's proceedings. This is one of the two event chairs who brought all of this together. And the person we're gonna welcome to the stage embodies some of the values that make the St. Louis startup ecosystem so amazing, and also has been instrumental in building it over the last decade. This is someone who spent 20 years building startups in Silicon Valley, and then 10 years ago, moved back to become an instrumental force in building Cultivation Capital, who's a general partner there and has helped build up the ecosystem, bringing entrepreneurs and capital and investment into the community. This is one of tonight's two co-chairs.
Everyone, let's please give a big warm welcome to John True.
For those of you who don't know Luke, Luke is one of the rising stars, CEOs of startups in the area, went through the Arch Grants program, is in the process doing big, big things. I am honored, quite honestly. We were asked at Cultivation Capital to be a part of the program to represent the honoree tonight for Entrepreneur of the Year, Jim Eberlin, and he's a good friend. Bring it up. Just an amazing entrepreneur and even a better man. You'll learn more as we go through the night, but very proud to get a chance to represent Cultivation Capital to honor Jim. Also kind of humbled and honored, the main force for the gala has always been to welcome the new cohort of Arch Grants recipients, which we will do with fanfare tonight. I'm very excited about the new cohort. But I believe that this event has really grown from being the Arch Grant Gala to kind of the preeminent startup community event in our area. We have representatives from all part of the ecosystem in the room, and it is really the place to network, to get to know folks, to really celebrate our success and the progress that we have made as a city and a community in the startup community. And you know, it kind of goes to the circular economy of our startup world, where a decade ends, Arch Grants is a decade in, and the great news about that is that we now have matured that group to start spawning all kinds of new participants in the community. We have, and we'll tell stories tonight about entrepreneurs that have had great successes and exits, moved on to start up new companies, entrepreneurs that have exited, started investing in the community, and folks that have participated in the community, they've gone on to support the rest of the startups in the area. So the ecosystem is really growing at a 10X factor, which is obviously the branding for tonight. I'd like to start with kind of recognizing the vision of the Arch Grants leaders. As most of you know, it was founded a decade ago. Jerry Schlichter, Joe Schlafly, Bob Guller, and Zach Boyers were the founders who had a vision to really fill a spot in our community that was really needed. They have stuck with that vision through execution to create what is a legacy now, an endowment that will go on for the rest of our lifetime in terms of supporting the startup community in St. Louis. So let's give them, please, a round of applause. A few other folks from the Arch Grants community, Richard Tao, who's also a board member, and they call him the Galo Maestro. He is why we punch above our weight in terms of the majesty of this event. It is a magnificent event done, as you know, very professionally, and he is one of the key kind of implementers behind that program. We're very thankful for his effort. In addition to that, board member Matt Badler, who's chairman today, and then I want to especially represent the leaders of Arch Grants. So first was Ginger, who got it off the ground. I can't see. Emily, are you out there somewhere? If you've been involved in Arch Grants, you know Emily well, but she was the penultimate scale-up CEO of Arch Grants. She took something that was very special and really advanced it. She advanced it in the amount of money that's invested in startups. She invested especially in the management team, brought the management team to make it something that could scale and withstand the test of time, and she broadened out the spaces that we invest in. As most of you know, she had a geospatial under her helm, and she developed a new leader. And as we invest in companies all the time, we're looking for depth at the management team, and Gabe has now taken over, and Gabe, don't screw it up. You're doing a great job so far. So I kind of mentioned the ecosystem. So I want to recognize kind of all parts of the ecosystem. We're going to talk about the new cohort, but we have several success stories that, in case you haven't followed the stories, I just want to spend a couple minutes talking about some of the great stuff that's going on in the community. You know, sometimes we get down on ourselves and we can't see the material progress, but we are doing some tremendous things as far as it is startup community and building companies that will endure, bring great talent, and bring great capital to the community. First, one of the Arch Grant Award winners was Genioscopy. Do we have the Genioscopy folks in town? Woohoo! Those of you who don't know, so they were a very early stage startup when they got their Arch Grant. And they have been doing magnificent work. So for those of you who don't know, they have new technology that is going to impact people's lives all over the world. They will diagnose early colorectal cancer without colonoscopies. They're in the final stages of testing, and you're going to hear great things about the expansion of their business and the impact they're going to have on our community, but the rest of the world. So it's really fun to see their success story. Congratulations, Genioscopy. One that's near and dear to my heart is Noonlight. Noonlight was an Arch Grant recipient 5 years ago, and did exactly what Arch Grants was meant to do. So Zach Wheeler graduated from Mizzou, started a company while he was in college, moved to LA, lived on the beach, wanted to be part of the great entrepreneurial surfers in LA, and Arch Grants came along and said, hey, we'd like to give you a grant, but why don't you come back to St. Louis? With a little help from his mom, we got him back, and it's been a great story. So just this year, as a matter of fact, just 60 days ago, Noonlight exited. They sold to a company called Alarm.com, and what Noonlight ended up having is a very special technology. They use artificial intelligence to apply to security cameras that are on the Internet, and they use the artificial intelligence to identify safe and dangerous situations, then automatically over the Internet go to emergency responders to bring folks to the building. And now Alarm.com, which is a very large public company, is using them as the basis for the next generation technology platform, and will build New Light's organization right here in St. Louis, from a startup in LA back to St. Louis to a large scale-up set of talent and impact on the region. So congratulations, Arch Grants and Zach Wheeler. Couple more. Ronick, you're in the house, right? Raise your hand. Anybody that knows Ronick? He's a dynamic leader. He was involved in Arch Grant with what ended up being a branded company called Label Insight. They did big data around food ingredients and health, tracking the health of the ingredients in our consumer packaged goods. He led that company, had a great exit for his investors and for his employees. Now he's moved on to a follow-on CEO opportunity of the company called Price FX. He's in line, if he continues on this path, potentially to be recognized as Jim Eberlin has as an Entrepreneur of the Year in the future. But he gives of his time back to Arch Grants. He was the first executive resident at Arch Grants and represents our community everywhere. Congratulations, Ronick. Last but not least, he's not be happy that I recognize him, but I want to recognize people that haven't gone through Arch Grants as well, just so you know how this circular economy has started to work in St. Louis in terms of we've had a long enough investment and focus on our tech startup scene that we're starting to see benefits in multi-generations. So one of the star CEOs in town is David Carandish. David, where are you at? Raise your hand. I bring David up only that he represents what we look at through Arch Grants and at Cultivation Capital as kind of very representative of the kind of entrepreneurs that we're happy to have in our ecosystem. He had a tremendous success with a company called Answers.com, if you don't know that, but really impacted the community in terms of talent, in terms of investment, in terms of returns for those investors. Got done with that and put his time into philanthropy. And then to start his next company. Started his next company, a great artificial intelligence-based company in town that is improving the way we work with artificial intelligence, but also is very active in investing in early stage startups. He too is would be a worthy representative for a future Entrepreneur of the Year for our community, but he represents some of the best that we have in town. David, thank you for showing up and really appreciate and enjoy the relationship. And so, in addition to entrepreneurs, the investment community has grown logarithmically. We have representation tonight from Arch Grants. If you don't know Arch Grants, I'm sorry, Arch Grants, from Arch Angels. And they've been involved in the community since 2005. They've invested in well more than 50 companies. They have it's successful business leaders that take very early stage pitches and invest high-risk companies and have produced some great results. They're a great contributor to the investment community and the entrepreneurial system here. I want to recognize Don Rubin from BioSTL and the Danforth family for getting us started with life sciences almost 20 years ago that has now produced tremendous infrastructure with the Danforth Center in town, as well as a bunch of companies that have gone on to raise capital, produce talent, and then invest in future talent going forward. So thank you, Don Rubin and the Danforths. Last but not least, Jack Bader, are you in the room? Yes, yes, yes. So Jack Bader we have enough time to go through them all. We have several great acceleration programs in town, early seed investing programs. Jack does one of the more professional jobs. He's just west of the river. So Mr. Page, we got to get him over here into St. Louis County sometime soon. But he does a great job at 1904 Labs. He's investing in early stage companies. And we're really, really happy you're part of the ecosystem and the value that you're producing is recognized across the board. Last but not least, we have, I was looking at the list of attendees, and part of this kind of circular economy has a whole set of folks in the room that support the ecosystem. So we have, you know, sponsors and folks that have really embraced our startup ecosystem that are in marketing services and the accounting firms, legal firms have all come up with programs to make it affordable for them to engage, for startups to engage in professional services. And now, after a decade, we're starting to get big enough and have some standalone companies that are now great customers for those investments that the marketing services have made. So I want to thank those corporate sponsors and those service providers to the startup community that are here tonight. And last but not least, We have a whole set of cottage industry now, folks that have graduated from the ecosystem. They've started their own companies, not necessarily to build on venture capital invested companies, but are building their own sole proprietorships to support the ecosystem. I'll throw out a couple names, Christy Jones, Amy Cole, Becky Scoobish, all came out of great companies in town. Now they support those folks on a regular basis. They invest in their time, oftentimes at no cost, and then oftentimes they help our startup ecosystem really not make some of the same mistakes that most of us made along the way. So I want to congratulate Arch Grants for what is a really awesome, not only an awesome program, but the one that now we're absolutely confident is going to endure over the next decade. And in combination with that, want to recognize the entire community here comes together, and hopefully we'll continue to turn what started as 100 folks in a room to 800 folks, and I'm hoping we can take that up a step change to somewhere between 1,000 and 2 next year. Thank you very much for having us, and what I'd like to do now is take a moment to turn the stage over to a video that will give us a little overview of the impact that my friend Jim Eberlin has had on our community. Take it away.
I remember this one time we flew to Arizona to do a demo. I was supposed to do the demo. He was supposed to do the sales pitch. And something happened. My mom called me all hysterical about something, and I got really upset. And I was trying to really hide it from Jim because we were going to go to this major deal presentation. We're just sitting in the car. I couldn't even talk because I was so rattled. Jim is the kind of guy that even if you don't tell him anything, he would sense that out. And we came to the client, and without even saying anything, he just went out and did the demo too. Damn, flew me over to Arizona and graciously allowed me not to do my job. This was the only time he ever did the demo instead of me. So it was clear that this was, I got you. So we have been married 34 years. Jim is from North County. Both of us were born and raised in St. Louis. He was a typical good kid, high school, hardworking family, typical American family. What happened was he saw a need in the industry and he knew what it needed. So he created that software.
And competing big players like Hyperion, that used to be the market leader, we were building the cloud version of a similar product. And we were successful with that.
When Jim started Host Analytics, there was no funds to support someone like Jim. You had to build your own network in town, or you went to the West Coast. And it was that journey and that educational process that imparted so many of the future ideas on Jim. You know, we were so lucky for him to bring that all back to St. Louis.
What I learned out in the Bay Area is what it means to really grow and how fast you grow.
Jim was groundbreaking in, you know, being able to come to Silicon Valley, attract high quality investors multiple times.
I think Jim is great when it comes to the early stages of the company, but he has demonstrated more than once, first of all, that he can get a company off the ground, which is really a big deal, and make it successful. And then at some point, turn it over either to an acquirer, right, like it happened in TopOPPS, or to another CEO.
When I think of Jim, what makes him so unique is I'm pretty confident he's probably the nicest person I've ever met.
Humility is important, obviously. And starting a conversation with a smile is also very important.
So I would say in general, just the generosity and kindness are two words that, you know, I would describe Jim as a person.
His ability to stay even-keeled and calm in situations is definitely a gift for him.
the respect that he has for employees and the way he treats his employees, I think it has made him successful because people want to go the extra mile for him.
You know, 30 years ago when we started the first business, when payroll was tight and there wasn't money to meet all the payroll, he didn't get a paycheck.
He's a very religious man, and I think that's a steadying force in his life.
You know, I think it's helpful to have something. I've always been big on my faith. That helps out quite a bit. But I did learn to be humble and thankful for everybody in the company. I mean, every part of these startups are essential, right? A startup equals essential people.
I think his leadership comes from being strong in his faith and knowing that putting others first is the right thing to do in God's eyes. And that is a faith thing. That's what God wants us to do. He wants us to think about other people first.
As entrepreneurs and CEOs, it's a lonely job. And when you can find somebody that does the same job and that you can talk to and has been through some of the things you've been through, I find that super valuable.
I don't think it's ever been about the money or the status or his ego or his own success. I think it's always been about, how can I make an impact? How can I make a difference?
Creating a product that is beneficial to the industry and giving people jobs, that really motivates him. He's not worried about getting credit for things. He's more concerned about moving forward and hitting the wins for the team.
Jim is exceptional at understanding customer needs. And understanding customer needs and reflecting them to a solution. So if you combine that with the ability to look over the horizon, you have some really innovative solutions.
I mean, Jim invented the customer success industry, right? I think most people would agree. And so, and that's grown. There are several companies in addition to Gainsight who are in that market. So it's really focusing in on what does the market need and what do they need right now?
His number one focus is the customer. And so he's always trying to understand in the problem that he's trying to solve, how is the customer going to be impacted?
The customer is so important. And it's so important for a founder to talk to the customers. You talk about keeping that passion and not losing that passion. The way when I have a bad day, you know what I do? I go talk to one of my customers. And they'll tell me, they'll tell me a great story like, oh my gosh, Jim, this is the most wonderful thing. Look what it did this last quarter for me. Or they'll say, you know, Jim, if you did this here, that would improve things so much. Those kind of things just energize. It's like, oh my gosh, I was missing that.
I mean, I'm just so proud of Jim, and I think he's just done such a great job, and I'm so excited to see what he does next.
I know that my kids think he's the best dad in the whole world, and I know that they will always have a really close relationship. I couldn't imagine doing life with anybody else. We're really excited about, you know, all the things that have happened and where we're headed from here.
Please welcome Jim Eberlin, founder of Host Analytics, Gainsight, and TopOPPS, and John True, general partner of Cultivation Capital.
Really cool.
I'm looking forward to this. So most of you know that Jim is, we call him the hat tricker, right? He's had three in a row great successful startups. You can do your own math in your head, but less than 10% on each one, three in a row, is in the thousands and thousands to one for that to happen. And it takes a pretty special leader to get after that. So what we thought we'd do is spend a little time trying to extract some stories of the magics to Jim's success. And I'll start with one. People talk about great characteristics of entrepreneurs, and it almost always comes up that it's determination, stick-to-itiveness, resilience. Thomas Edison said, many failures are not realizing how close they were to success when they quit. So, Jim, if you could talk a little bit about kind of grit, resiliency, and not giving up, and maybe one or two times where you were close, but you did not.
Oh, yeah, there's plenty where I did not. And, you know, the first thing that comes to mind is at Host Analytics. I remember going out to the Bay Area. You saw Evangelos up there. Evangelos is great. And and you also saw Kevin McClellan. And he got me 11 appointments to pitch Bay Area investors. So I totally blew 10 of them. And I didn't give up. I did that one more, and it was Evangelos that was, you know, and I can almost feel like, you know, okay, I'm going to do this. And so anyway, it was like that was a big deal that to me to get that term sheet. At Host Analytics, we, you know, it didn't stop there. So I got the term sheet. And things were going great. I had a guy named Rick Rutowski. I had Karen Williams with me. It was a great company. We're doing well. And the financial crisis hit. And so we were, before then, we were signing up Pitney Bowes, JP Morgan Chase, Procter & Gamble. And that's why Evangelos saw through all my flaws. And he went ahead and gave me a term sheet. And so I felt real confident going into that we're just going to kill it from there on out. I remember we goose-egged the next 3 months. We didn't sell a thing because the financial crisis hit. This was back in 2008. So, again, we didn't give up. We just, because, like, that could happen, right? Like, we could have just ran out of money and not gotten a B round. And what we did is we switched over to our existing customers and focus more on selling the existing customers and then manage cash. And it's funny, I talk about managing cash, John, because I think what's cool about our Midwestern roots is that we focus on efficiency. That's one of the advantages we have. It's one of our, you were calling it a superpower. And but out in the Bay Area, they really know how to grow a company and, you know, really grow it into, you know, no longer a unicorn, but a decacorn. So I learned about that with them. But I remember one time we were going to lose $15,000 on a deposit, and because they wanted to change one of the decisions I wanted to make. And it's like, we're going to lose 15 grand. And it was so funny because my board members kind of looked at me and are like, isn't he cute? They just wanted to pat me on the head. They're like, Jim, we're about to raise another $20 million round. And you're, you know, but anyway, I learned a lot about really going after the market leadership and from them. And that was really a cool thing. And so, yeah.
So, Randy, what do you say when he spends an extra $15,000? The lesson for many of the entrepreneurs in the room is, you know, we are, you know, entering into and have been in some uncertain economic times, and many of us haven't been through that in the past, and know that just good, tight cost control and ambition, stick-to-itiveness, and focus on what you know well, in this case, Jim, did a great job of focusing on his own customers rather than spending money to go in to get new customers, which was very expensive, and spent that time and survived during the, if you remember, in 2008, it was a pretty dark time for almost a year, and did a great job of survival and came out on the other side. So Jim, the biggest win of your three was Gainsight, I think. And, you know, I don't think you changed, and I think the talent around you didn't change. But one thing that kind of that I've seen, and famous investors always talk about this. One is Brad Gerstner, who's a famous investor from Altimeter Investments, who did Facebook and Google early on. Says, get a great idea, solve a real problem, but make sure it's on the tailwind of a mega trend, something that is really pushing everyone forward in that environment. So how was Gainsight part of a mega trend?
Yeah, well, I certainly was experiencing the problems that it solved, which is churn. So Gainsight is all about eliminating churn and getting ahead, way ahead of the of a problem with a customer before they churn. And so that was definitely a great opportunity. I was able to convince the VP of Customer Success for Marketo. Marketo was a big sweetheart enterprise SaaS company in the Bay Area. So that helped out. So I had this real credible convincer that came on board with me. And I remember we were doing really well. We were signing up a lot of big enterprise SaaS companies. And along comes this service source. They were a big operation at the time. And they said they were either going to build this or we're going to buy it. And so they ended up making me an offer. It was $8 million. And I remember talking over with Randy. Randy and I said, we're early on. We don't have a lot of money in this. And it's, you know, just a couple of months. I talked to Brian Matthews. He said, yeah, we just invested like a month ago, so it'd be a good quick turnaround, you know, so maybe it's all right. But he goes, look out for the haircut. And then sure enough, they burned 2 months. I thought this was going to happen. I thought this acquisition was going to happen. They burned 2 months of our time doing due diligence. They give us a big haircut. I back out of the deal, but now I am running out of money. And so Randy and I, we know that Randy and I are big in our faith, so we're praying a lot. And so I get an email from Roger Lee of Battery Ventures, and he tells me, he basically says, hey, I'm going to invest in you or this other Bay Area company, Tatango. And I remember I was in Randy's sister's house on Christmas Eve, and I snuck my laptop in, snuck out in the back room while the kids were out in the other room, and I'm checking. Sure enough, I get an email on Christmas Eve. I get a term sheet from Roger Lee. He picked us over to Tango. So I remember going out and opening the door up afterwards and yelling, okay, kids, you can open up your Christmas presents now. Don't worry about those price tags on there. I just left them on. But anyway, so it was a great thing. We went on from there. It was very good.
Jim's a humble man. He was a visionary who created a multi-billion dollar space, which is now called customer success. And it was on the backs of early stage software business in general going from what was called perpetual to a recurring license model, which meant that, as you all know in this room, if you're in the software business, you have to earn your customer's commitment every year on renewal. And so Jim saw that and created a platform that would help companies take care of that annual recurring commitment and worry about short-term health of the customer versus moving on to the next one. So great vision and execution behind it was a big part of that.
Well, I'm glad. I was going to say it was dumb luck, but I like your answer better.
And so one of the most famous venture capitalists in the Bay Area, although, you know, I'm sorry to keep saying the Bay Area because we are now, the evolution of the last decade has moved much of the capital and talent to start being dispersed around the U.S., but Roloff Botha, who is the managing director at Sequoia, always looks for what he calls problem founding team fit. How much passion and knowledge do they have about the problem they're trying to solve? And are they missionary to stick through that through thick and thin, or are they mercenary trying to start a business to make some money? And they only invest, supposedly, in that mercenary kind. And so I thought I'd talk a little bit about TopOPPS, your last company, and kind of how your knowledge and pain around forecasting caused you to see this opportunity around forecasting.
Yeah. Well, first thing, you kind of stirred up something with me. I always hear this stat about
startup failures, you know, because if you lose a passion, that's what happens. The founder will tend to stop. Okay, they give up. Well, I won't say give up. That sounds bad, because it's a very honorable thing to go back. A lot of times you go back to your job because you're making a ton of money before, and you lose your passion for what you have. And also I hear this other stat that says the main reason is you run out of money. You don't run out of money. You run out of passion because you lost your unique advantage, and will convince that was able to really get the respect of the buyer. But I will tell you with TopOPPS, that one was one where I got my head over my skis a bit early, because early on we had a great product, but you got to keep rechecking the product to make sure it's really that you have proof that it really really matters to the customer. And we Amy Cole's out there. She built an awesome marketing engine for us. We had a great. There's a bunch of other salespeople out there that the Balto founders, everybody. They really refined our sales process. Christy Jones was in. I always had her in to make sure she was keeping that going. But we had that going. We ran up revenue quick early, but then we hit a brick wall. Unfortunately, my CTO came over. The old band got back together again from Host Analytics and Gainsight, now at TopOPPS. And my CTO came over a shook and built. We had a great team before, but he was able to come in with the right team to really make the scale. But with TopOPPS, we were able to once we made it, a solid, rock solid product that could scale. Then I get hit by my competitor outraising me by millions of dollars. So now I have no unfair advantage. I have no, who cares if I got a credible convincer. But I was able to switch over to partners. And it was the partners that ended up, helping me to match my big competitor that outraised me. And that eventually two partners led to two offers from two of the partners, and here we are today in St. Louis is exactly. Yeah. Good company, really good company. You saw Chris Cabrera up there, great company, and he's growing the team here. JJ's still with me. She's JJ is the Jose Akendo of our company. I put her in every position.
Hopefully getting a sense for the humility and kind of servant leader that Jim Eberlin is. Last topic I'd like to talk about is kind of leadership. My experiences with you, Jim, is that, one of your secret powers is that every place you've gone, there are people have come with you from previous companies. Another secret power is that many of the folks that you've worked with have gone on to either become their own entrepreneurs or gone on to great success elsewhere. So two quotes. The best reward is to get there surrounded by winners, not by yourself. And last, demanding, supportive, genuine are traits of great servant leadership. That's Brian Chesky from Airbnb. Can you talk a little bit about just kind of leadership in general and how you think about that?
Well, clear vision is super, super important. We always kept ours real simple, didn't we? We had three letters. I've always made sure it was like three letters so I could remember. It was truth, TPR, truth, performance, respect. What was funny is like a week ago I forgot one of them, and so next company I'm going to just make it two letters. But I always wanted to remember that. But I got a great team. Always had a great team around me. Just been so blessed with that. And I tell you, I really have enjoyed seeing this team really become successful. There's a lot of successful businesses. There's a lot of successful people. Just enjoyed that. And I can't tell you, I just enjoyed the ride along the way with my ultimate teammate, my wife, Randy, who I tell you, best business partner in the world. She's awesome.
How about that for Randy? Woohoo! With that, we'll wrap up. Jim, thank you so much for the impact you've had on our lives and the community's lives. And if you ever doubt whether nice guys finish first or last, Jim is a great example of how you can treat people with respect and win the race. Thank you very much for listening to us.
Thank you.
We actually have an award for you as well. Thank you so much for your extraordinary contribution to the St. Louis region as an entrepreneur. You're an OG. Thank you so much.
Everyone, let's give it up one more time for Jim Eberlin and John True.
Woo! Oh, okay.
You're crashing the photo.
Well, everyone's watching us.
I know I can say personally that those folks have both been mentors, and I know a lot of folks in the room tonight can say that for both of them as well. This has been the highlight of coming back together. We're so glad to be here. This is the first time Arch Grants has been able to bring everyone from the St. Louis community back together since COVID. And we could tell, because we were trying so hard to quiet you all down at the beginning of the night, that everyone is very excited to get to talking to all the wonderful people at your table. So we have a wonderful dinner coming out. We're going to have 45 minutes to reconnect in person, enjoy this time together, and Lisa and I will see you in about 45 minutes to welcome a new Arch Grants cohort into our community. But until then, enjoy your dinner, and we'll see you soon.
Please enjoy.
In 2012, Bob Guller, Jerry Schlichter, Joe Schlafly, and Zach Boyers noted that St. Louis was losing many of our Fortune 500 corporations and having trouble attracting and retaining big business. They felt the best way to combat this was a grassroots effort aimed at growing small businesses that would stimulate the local economy immediately and eventually transform into new Fortune 500 companies with a solid foundation here. Thus, Arch Grants and their global startup competition was born.
Arch Grants is bringing entrepreneurs here and keeping those that we have.
And our innovative model is bringing early stage companies to St. Louis with equity-free funding, which is unheard of at the scale that we do it at.
We run around and said, look, the way we're really going to make a difference is we're going to get 10, 20 entrepreneurs every year to come to St. Louis and start their companies here. We're really going to make it happen. Please believe us and give us money. And the great thing about St. Louis is people did.
And the goal is to make this a burgeoning entrepreneurial community, keep our young people, and make people excited about what's going on here.
The way that we ignite ingenuity and innovation in St. Louis is through our global startup competition.
Since Arch Grants' creation, over 130 early stage companies have been awarded $50,000 in equity-free funding, totaling over $7 million in grants. And most are still active in St. Louis. Judges in diverse industries provide feedback and select 40 finalists to invite to Pitch Day. This gives entrepreneurs the opportunity to present a 15-minute business pitch. Grant recipients are chosen based on viability, scalability, and most importantly, fit within the St. Louis community.
The real value that our companies see in an Arch Grant is the follow-on, the connections we're able to make after the fact. We offer, in addition to that $50,000, they receive pro bono or highly discounted legal services, accounting services, marketing services, those types of things. And then they also are entered into this cohort of the other recipients that have won their year. And it's just 18 entrepreneurs or 19 entrepreneurs that are building their businesses here.
One of the most attractive pieces about St. Louis is everybody knows everybody. So if you know what somebody needs to be successful, you can help them get there by connecting them with another individual that you know.
Receiving an Arch Grant is a mark of validation from both the organization itself, our board, and more importantly, the St. Louis community.
We are here to affect positive change because we are building a company that seeks to do something better than how we thought it was done in the past.
You're looking for companies that are innovative, that can have a change to their employees and the people they hire, that can contribute to the diversity of the business community, so that it's not just the same old people all the time who are creating the accumulations of wealth and then setting the agenda for our community. if it's the same old people again, we'll get the same priorities again and again and again.
And our long-term goal is that these companies that we bring will thrive and grow in St. Louis and give back to the community. And we're grateful that that's already started to happen.
We look at diversity from a number of different perspectives. We look at diversity of opinions, diversity of thoughts, diversity when it comes to race and gender and age and immigrants. And all of that is under the umbrella of that is what it takes from our perspective to build a rich economy.
We don't want all St. Louis grants. We want people that have come from the outside of St. Louis who are really coming to start a business and a life here and are moving their families and their businesses to St. Louis to totally engage in the community.
But by looking for people who are diverse and bring different perspective, then those who do well in business will represent a wider swath of our society. And then the priorities that come from those people who have the means to fund those priorities will come from people with a wider perspective.
It is shocking how much we undervalue St. Louis as a city, and putting St. Louis on the map is part of what Arch Grants is really about.
What I'm thinking about is actually sparking positive change in how our economy is developing, how we are developing a diverse and inclusive workforce, how we are giving people opportunity here in St. Louis, and that's what we continue to do.
Arch Grants, a St. Louis-based venture philanthropy nonprofit, works to build up promising startups and enhance the local business community. They offer a $50,000 equity-free grant and priceless support services in exchange for asking the companies to relocate to St. Louis for at least a year. You can say they claim their new executive director as another of their success stories. St. Louis native Emily Loza Bush moved away from the city to work in Chicago and D.C. in 2005, but recently returned to the city because of the thriving innovation boom St. Louis has experienced in recent years. Come with us as HECTV President Dennis Riggs sits down with Arch Grants Executive Director Emily Loza Bush, and they talk about the vital role of Arch Grants in the St. Louis economy and how our innovation community is putting St. Louis back on the map.
I've got to ask you first about your name, because when the press release said she's returning to St. Louis because of family, and people said there's a Bush on that name, of course she's got family in St. Louis.
This is not the first time I've heard that, but I have no relation to the St. Louis-based Bush family. Loza Bush, the hyphenated name, is actually my husband's family's name. He's German. My maiden name is Pratzel, and we had a Jewish bakery. I think it's four generations of Pratzels have been here for 98 years. Back when my grandpa was active in the bakery, I remember going as a kid to the plant and watching them make the bagels, and they made them with that water technique. You know, it's something like that when you grow up in that atmosphere. There's certain places I'll walk into and it smells like the bakery smelled or something like that, and it just brings me right back there.
You're 5 years old again.
Yes, exactly. And I want some cookies.
Please.
Yeah, sure.
What about this job brought you back here?
It's an interesting story. So I believe that Arch Grants is actually a big part of what brought me back to St. Louis, but I didn't know at the time that it was Arch Grants. So I had lived in Chicago for a number of years. I met my husband there, got my MBA, had worked in the nonprofit sector for a long time, moved to DC, and had been inclined to come back to St. Louis. But having left in 2005, wasn't really sure what was here for us. I had spent so much of my adult career and my life in more urban areas, walkable areas. I wanted to retain some of that, and my husband, as I mentioned, is German, is not from St. Louis. And so I was telling somebody this, and what she said to me was, you should really go look and see what's happening in that innovation area. So downtown, midtown, Cortex, Central West End, those areas, and see what's happening. And so we did. We did some research. We looked around. We saw just the incredible energy and vibrancy in St. Louis, particularly in the downtown area. And it was so exciting to both my husband and I that it was enough for us to say, all right, we don't know what it is yet, but we're ready to come back.
This wasn't the St. Louis you left.
Exactly, yeah. And it was so exciting to see. And we're both kind of builders, as I would describe us, and as we like to be a part of something that's that you have the ability to be a little bit gritty, to be a little bit innovative, and help to form what it's going to become. And I was just waiting for the right opportunity to be a part of building that energy that had ultimately brought me back, which is interesting. In a lot of ways, my story is very parallel to the Arch Grant story and what we're trying to do by bringing entrepreneurs back here. It's very cyclical, right? It's both having them feed into the ecosystem and create that innovation and excitement, but also having them see the energy that's being created here in St. Louis and wanting to be part of that.
And let's talk a little bit more about Emily.
Yeah.
Who is Emily and what's her background?
We live in the Central West End. Love it there. Whenever somebody says I don't, and when I talk to somebody who says my kids left, they're about your age, I want them to get back to St. Louis, I always say just next time they come in town, if they're willing to, send them over to my house and we'll talk them into it. We'll do dinner. Well, if they've got little kids, they'll go out and play on the street with our kids. But we love our life here in St. Louis.
And we is?
Yes, sorry. My husband, myself, and I have two little boys, 5 and 18 months. We like to just be kind of tourists in our own city. So every weekend, you'll find us exploring and venturing out to something. We went to Cahokia Mounds a couple weekends ago. And we go to the Art Museum, the History Museum, and just try to see all these incredible free things that St. Louis has to offer that in some ways I feel like even I, being from here, take for granted because, oh yeah, I know that the zoo's great, I've been there. So that's really fun. But then I would say the majority of our time we spend wrangling the boys and just really playing out in the street with our neighbors.
Let's switch now to Arch Grants.
Yeah.
Do you think most St. Louisans even know there is an Arch Grants or what it does?
It's an interesting question because I think within the startup ecosystem, the downtown ecosystem in St. Louis, I would say 100% yes. I think we've been around for almost six years at this point. We've brought over 100 companies to this community and entrepreneurs, and many of them are still active. But then I think once you start to get outside of that, and I think it's part of the interesting role that I can play as somebody, as an outsider coming into this role, is I don't think there's as much knowledge. I think there's a lot of people out there who want to be helpful and want to have a positive impact on St. Louis, but they don't know, similar to me, where they see some of this energy and they know a little bit about what might be happening here, but they don't know where that's coming from.
Or how could I be involved in it?
And that's the thing, it's a lot harder to be involved in energy than an organization that's helping to create that. And so that's part of what our role can be going forward, is looking at all of the work that Arch Grants and our partners around the ecosystem have done and make sure that a whole bunch of people in St. Louis and around the country know what's happening and know why it's happening.
How would the average St. Louisan be a part of the success here, join in and help out?
I mean, there's a lot of ways to get involved. Reaching out to get involved as a judge, as a volunteer. If you'd like to get involved with our companies in some way, just let us know what your interest is. And then, of course, coming to our gala, which is every year in November, which is a celebration of entrepreneurship in St. Louis. And I think it's so rare to get the amount of people excited to come to a gala right now in this day and age where there's a lot of things going on and a lot of organizations are moving away from that. But to see the energy, there's something special about that. And there's something magical about the fact that we announce our cohort at the gala.
Do you feel that's one of the important parts of Arch Grants, is to be a spark plug for innovation in here?
St. Louis has been on a national spotlight many times in the last year or so as one of the top places to start a business, one of the top places for millennials to live. We've got some of that magic happening that when you see a community of innovators, affordable cost of living, a downtown that has, as many people have put it to me, and the amount of beautiful, old, original architecture that we have in this downtown, other cities would kill for. And you take those things and then you put them together and have organizations like Arch Grants and others in this ecosystem to help leverage those and make those connections, then you have the ability to create something really exciting.
How does St. Louis compare to other cities in terms of innovation communities?
I try not to compare us, honestly. I think there's things that we have to offer here that other places don't. And for example, one of the things that I hear time and time again from our entrepreneurs is that particularly Arch Grant recipients who have that Arch Grant stamp of approval, that people will take your meeting. We make a connection, they make a connection and say, I'm an Arch Grant recipient, and they get in the door. And then it's also the, I'm a business leader in St. Louis and I want St. Louis to succeed too. And so if you're doing something actively to make that happen, I'm willing to listen to what you have to say. And then that's where the connections happen.
Would there be any success stories? You mentioned 100 some odd companies that I would, as an average St. Louis, recognize right away, a name, a product?
So it's interesting. So one of the things that we look at when we are vetting our companies or our applicants, and maybe I should talk a little bit about the way that we do that. So the way that we ignite ingenuity and innovation in St. Louis is through our global startup competition. And that's a competition where we take applicants from around the country, around the world, and have them submit business plans, submit a whole bunch of material, do several levels of vetting to get to a class of between 15 and 20 companies that we feel have viability, have scalability, and then I would say most importantly are a good fit in St. Louis. And what I mean by that is, as a nonprofit, our mission, our goal is to grow the new economy or grow economic development in the St. Louis region. And so what we're looking to do as we think about our companies is, does it make sense for them to be here?
Right. You're not looking to give money and mentoring and then have them run off to another city.
Exactly. And so the thought is that we give this $50,000 equity-free grant. And then what I've heard more and more, though, as time has gone on, is that the money, the capital, is really important. It allows a lot of the companies to either, if it's move here, to make a hire that they hadn't been able to make before, those types of things. But that the real value that our companies see in an Arch grant is the follow-on, the connections we're able to make after the fact. We offer, in addition to that $50,000, they receive pro bono or highly discounted legal services, accounting services, marketing services, those types of things. And then they also are entered into this cohort of the other recipients that have won their year. And it's just 18 entrepreneurs or 19 entrepreneurs that are building their businesses here.
Become a supportive community?
That's what we're trying to build. And I think that we have some great examples of that happening. So to directly answer your question, I would say some of the ones that you may have heard of, depending on what type of news you read, Observable Networks is one that we funded a few years ago that just had an exit where they were acquired by Cisco. And that's really exciting for Arch Grants because Cisco is coming here. They're keeping the jobs here. And Cisco's never had a presence in St. Louis before. So it's an opportunity for, through one of our startups, for a large company from the coast to come and see what's happening in St. Louis.
Well, from what you're talking about, with all the things that this organization does, you must be a tremendous multitasker. What's an average day in the office like?
I have actually a story that I was just telling somebody last night, that my five-year-old, I guess one of his teachers or somebody, was asking, you know, what does your mom do or what do your parents do for a living? And my five-year-old said, my mom helps people. And his teacher said, oh, that's so great. What does she do? Thinking maybe he would say,
she's
a doctor. She's she's a first responder. She's something.
Yeah.
And he said, she emails. And I thought from his perspective, we tell him I help people and then he sees me email, maybe some conference calls. I mean, I think what a normal day in the office for me is actually not very much time in the office. Once our entrepreneurs are here, they're here for 12 months, hopefully longer, but they're required to be here for at least a year as part of their contract. We see that as kind of the starting point where we have the opportunity to get them invested in St. Louis, in the St. Louis community, in the St. Louis ecosystem, in the St. Louis, if they're interested in this, you know, the funding community here. And so it's important that our relationships with all of our partner organizations are strong and that they understand where we're going, I understand where they're going, so we can make those connections very seamlessly. A lot of my time is spent just finding out what's happening on everybody's plate and then doing a lot of connections. We're a privately funded organization. We're a nonprofit, 501c3. So it's very important to us that the community continue to see the value in what we're doing and invest in us, both in terms of their time, but also monetarily. And the community has been incredibly generous.
Could St. Louis do more in the way of venture capital to help support these groups?
There's absolutely opportunity for more people to find out about how do you invest in St. Louis startups, if that's something that you're interested in doing. A large percentage of our companies still are operating in St. Louis, which is fairly rare for startup organizations. But when we do talk to companies that are either considering leaving or do leave, there's two primary reasons that that's the case. It's follow-on funding and their access to that.
So if you're a potential venture capitalist, this is a good place to start. Knock on the door.
Absolutely. And then the second reason that a company or an entrepreneur does choose to leave, it's that they haven't found their connection with the community. They haven't found their home here. And so that's a place where I think Arch Grants can continue to be better. And we focus on this a lot already, but how can we make sure that our entrepreneurs from day one are also seeing St. Louis as home? Because that's, I mean, when you think of what St. Louis has to offer, you always hear it's a wonderful place to raise a family. It's a wonderful place to walk around. It's very affordable, those types of things. But until those can translate into a community of people that you feel like you belong with, then it doesn't mean a whole lot.
Tough question. We, over the last 3 years, have seen a number of disruptions in the St. Louis area, and protests and breaking of glass windows and that sort of thing. How does that affect the innovative community?
So when I think of the things that are happening in St. Louis right now, and honestly happening around the country in different ways, I think organizations like Arch Grants are imperative to have, because what we do is we are very intentionally bringing diverse perspectives together and asking our entrepreneurs to be part of the conversation. Come here, help us build St. Louis, help us build the St. Louis of the future. What I would encourage everybody to do, and this includes all of our entrepreneurs, all of the businesses that the 96 that have been here for more than a year, and then the 18 that have come in this year, to actively seek out the conversations that are going to lead to the change they want to see. And I think the great thing about Arch Grants companies is that they have already kind of put a stake in the ground saying, we are here to affect positive change because we are building a company that seeks to do something better than how we thought it was done in the past.
Positive social change is in their wheelhouse.
Absolutely. And it's in our wheelhouse, honestly. It was why we were created. Our founders were looking at St. Louis and looking at a lot of the trends that have been highly publicized over the last 10, 20 years and saying, how do we spark not only a positive narrative, because I think when I say those words now, it sounds like just a story we tell. What I'm thinking about is actually sparking positive change in how our economy is developing, how we are developing a diverse and inclusive workforce, how we are giving people opportunity here in St. Louis, and that's what we continue to do.
How do you help guide the judges to the types of companies that are going to really help St. Louis? Are they all just tech companies?
The answer is no. There are some tech companies, which just makes sense because, as I mentioned, St. Louis fit is a key criteria that we use, and it's a key criteria that we give to our judges. So we're industry agnostic in terms of the types of companies that we fund. But that being said, that we still focus on companies that have the best chance of success in St. Louis, which leads us down the road of ag tech, course, because there's fintech, financial technology, that's really been developing downtown. There's technology, just technology of all kinds, those types of areas. And then there's, because of the Fashion Fund and others, there's a growing fashion presence here in St. Louis, which is really interesting. This year's, we've had a couple of them in the past, but this is the first year that we've had two very fashion-focused companies within our portfolio.
Now, the innovative community, especially the tech sector, mm-hmm. has been under fire recently across the country for lack of diversity. Mm-hmm. It's too white, it's too male. Mm-hmm. Does that play into Arch Grants at all?
We look at diversity from a number of different perspectives. We look at diversity of opinions, diversity of thoughts, diversity when it comes to race and gender and age and immigrants. And all of that is under the umbrella of that is what it takes from our perspective to build a rich economy. One of the statistics that we're very proud of is the fact that 74% of our companies right now are either led or co-led by either a woman, a person of color, an immigrant, or a veteran. We are absolutely going to continue to track that. And like I said, it's because of the fact that we think that is imperative to creating the social environment and the rich social fiber that's going to make St. Louis successful.
But at the same time, you wouldn't pass up a good idea that happened to be white and male to reach out to diversity?
Yeah, no, I mean, I think what we are constantly working on is how do we make sure that every part of our process is as diverse and inclusive as possible. So that comes down to who are our judges and what's the perspective that they're going to have. As we look at even our outreach tactics, are we reaching out to a diverse audience, or are we going to some place that tends to target this group or this group? And if we're doing that, then are we doing that in an intentional way? And we talk about ourselves at the top of the funnel. I would even say one step above that, the top of our funnel, we're looking at filling that in a very strategic and intentional way that is focused on the best and the brightest and a diverse group that is going to bring a lot of different perspectives to the table.
Let's take a long view here. What is your hope, your goal, your dream for this organization for the future? What do you want to see it happen? What do you want to see it be, and what do you want to make it be?
I think that the role that Arch Grants is playing is absolutely critical at this point, in that we see ourselves as kind of the recruitment arm of the innovation ecosystem in St. Louis. So we are attracting and retaining entrepreneurs. We're bringing them in. Other people have described us as kind of the top of the funnel. And when I see the role that I want to see Arch Grants playing in the future, it's how are we getting the best possible entrepreneurs when they're going into St. Louis incubators, when they're getting follow-on funding in St. Louis, when they're getting involved in organizations and doing things like that, that they are taking their ideas and their mindsets and just making sure that is ingrained in the culture of St. Louis. And so as I think about our role, we're an economic development organization that really has the opportunity to also build the culture of innovation in St. Louis.
That's how you will judge your own success.
Right? Absolutely.
If the innovative community says, meet me in St. Louis.
I like it. Yes. Yeah.
Is this ingrained in your DNA? You come from a family of entrepreneurs, and now you're trying to help coalesce entrepreneurs.
One of our founders, Jerry Schlichter, has said that it's in my DNA because of the bakery and the entrepreneurs in my family. And I just laugh because by that same logic, I should also be a good baker, and I am not. I mean, I think that the way that my family came here, I believe it was in 1914, that my great-grandfather came to St. Louis and started the bakery and lived above it, as you did in those days, is inspiring. And I absolutely hope that I can help others build that same type of story in St. Louis.
The idea for the name Disrupto came from disrupting the television viewing experience. Our platform is called Context, which uses machine learning to enable users to ask questions about what they're watching, access supplemental information, and purchase products that appear on screen. So if you're watching a movie and you're not sure who's on screen, rather than just pulling out your phone and searching on a web browser and doing a reverse search for the cast list, you can just ask,
who's the guy in the middle?
Or who's the actress in the pink shirt? And you'll receive a supplemental visual response that perfectly answers your question without distracting from the original content. I'm 21 years old, so I just graduated from high school. I've really always been into inventing and the different applications for emerging technologies. So starting my junior year, I started really getting into different ways of leveraging those emerging technologies. And then senior year is when I formally started the company and started recruiting an engineering team. And here we are.
Who is that guy?
With our platform, you not only can say, like, who is that person, but you can also say, like,
who directed this?
Our platform leverages both natural language processing and computer vision to get a very in-depth understanding of what's on the screen and what it is you're asking about. Our system will interpret that request, shift its attention to that particular entity, and we will run face recognition, which identifies the subject, and then we present that visual response that answers the query. It's very important that users can use our platform however is comfortable to them. So that's been one of the things that we've worked on as we've been developing the platform, is making sure that people, when they're looking for information, they can ask a question and word that however is most natural to them. So we are not looking for specific keywords. We truly understand the language that people are using and what they're asking about, making it so that they don't have to make any complex queries. They can truly say, who is that? Or who's the dude in the shades, and really use any language that's most comfortable to them.
Who's that woman?
Our platform scans and encodes all of the current actors and actresses out there. So if they have a presence on the internet, they have a Wikipedia page, they've been in a recent movie, they will have been through our system, their face will have been scanned to compare against for future identifications. And so we keep a massive, massive database of millions of people with all of their biometric data ready to scan. We came up with the idea when we realized that there was no intelligent system that allowed people to ask questions. How tall is that guy? Voice assistants have existed for a while, so have search engines. You're able to ask how tall is the Burj Khalifa or who's the president of Haiti, but you're not actually able to ask questions about what is currently relevant, what you're currently looking at. So as soon as we realized that there was no system in place, you know, that it currently exists that allows for that, that's when we realized that there was definitely a large opportunity for us to be the ones to create that. It feels very great to have won Arch Grants. I think Arch Grants is one of the major things in St. Louis that we were really going after. Be able to get introduced to that network, make those connections, and find people that are going through the exact same entrepreneurial journey that we're going through. Our platform has been in development for about 1.5 years. We've been working on getting the core infrastructure ready for deployment, and we're going to be launching in early 2021 with our partners. We recently actually expanded into sports, but we're really wanting to cover everything. So product shopping, I want to buy the purse the girl on the left has, and also moving into the real world. So smart, you know, augmented reality glasses are becoming a thing. Apple's working on them, Google's working on them. So just like asking questions about what's on your screen, the same real world visual data would also fall into our framework. So you can ask questions about what you're seeing in the real world as well. That would be a huge privacy concern. So right now we only have celebrities and notable people into our databases. Context is just the beginning of Disruptel as a company. We are already in development of several other machine learning platforms that leverage our internal services, both computer vision and natural language processing. So you'll see more of Disruptel in the future.
A new ag tech company has emerged from the Donald Danforth Plant Science Center, proudly showcasing the Phenode. Plant scientists say it's an advancement in precision agriculture. The Phenode is a smart crop monitoring platform. When in action, the phenotyping station performs a number of tasks.
What do you think this thing does?
It's solar powered.
Okay, so the solar powers, that's right, it does turn into energy. What do we feel on our faces? Wind? Right, so we feel the wind on our face, so it'll do the direction of the wind, which is really cool. And it also has a camera. So right now, we could be getting our picture taken. A farmer could say, you know, they would be able to test the temperature and say, well, is it time for me to go out and do some planting yet?
The children are learning about the Phenode for the first time at the St. Louis Science Center. It's in the orchard part of the Grow exhibit. It's nothing these kids have seen in the farmlands or gardens before. The term phenotype refers to the observable characteristics and properties of an organism. And the Phenode is a smart phenotyping station for crops. There are many features for visitors to explore.
To remind people, or maybe even to teach them for the first time, how much technology is a part of agriculture. It's really scientific, and it's full of very precise measurements and a lot of what is called precision agriculture.
The people behind the creation of the Phenode are at the Donald Danforth Plant Science Center in St. Louis. They have testing locations here and in cornfields in the Midwest. With their success, the plant scientists launched the technology through their new startup company, Agrella Ecosystems. Nadia Shakur is co-founder. She explains how the Phenode is designed for farmers, growers, and researchers to help them manage crops.
It's equipped with all sorts of different types of sensors that are gathering data in the field and transmitting it to their mobile device, and also providing actionable advice for the grower to better manage their crops.
Environmental sensors for wind speed, humidity, temperature, carbon dioxide, rainfall, and more. There are also soil sensors for soil moisture,
temperature, nutrients, and pH. Shakur explains the Phenode has many features, including imaging, that makes their technology unique and comprehensive.
One of the most important aspects of it is the camera arm. So it's also taking photographs once every hour, both in regular RGB, kind of your normal cell phone camera images, as well as infrared.
And the measurements are taken in real time. Shakur says the company's app will provide an interactive tool for the user.
So through one app and one kind of interface, you're able to log into each of your Phenodes and be able to monitor your crops, track them, get alerts, and then ultimately we hope to develop a system where then you can also respond with automated systems, things like automated irrigation or pest control. So this interface right here is an example of what the interface would look like on your cell phone or your tablet. It is equipped with readings from all of the different sensors that are on your specific Phenode.
She explains how the idea began when they were looking for something just like this for their research and were surprised to learn it did not exist. So they set out to create it themselves.
There are crop monitoring devices, field monitoring devices. However, they're not very flexible and they're also not very affordable. And, you know, for our research purposes, where our research goals change, you know, every 6 months, every year, we need a device that was going to be flexible, affordable. We could mix and match different sensors based on our kind of our research goals. And we realized through talking with our network of people in the ag tech industry that this was a device that's like definitely needed.
The Phenode is customizable to the needs of the grower.
The sensor suite is designed to be completely adjustable to the user needs.
Such as strawberries.
Using the camera, the Phenode is identifying white flowers, counting them as they bloom. Combining that with data from the temperature sensors, the Phenode is providing automated weekly yield estimates, saving growers from having to walk through the fields counting the flowers themselves.
And for corn, the needs are different.
A lot of the analysis is coming from the image analytics, so looking at the picture and being able to identify how green the plant is. Is there disease infestation coming in through to the plants? How much light is coming into the canopy? So for example, for corn, light interception into the canopy is really important for how much yields you're going to get at the end of the season, and so we're tracking how much light is coming in. And so a lot of these are gauges for how the plant is going to produce and help guides you to make better decisions as the crops are growing, to maybe change things like increase your irrigation or go out there and make sure you spray for a particular disease at a specific point in time when it's actually happening.
Shakur believes the Phenode is the next smart step into the future of agriculture, and it's a proud part of the St. Louis Science Center's exhibit.
That's what's really cool about the Phenode, because it is kind of now, but it's also mainly what's going to be happening in the future, which is really cool.
For Innovations, I'm Kathleen Berger.
Good Life Growing is a social enterprise focused on combating urban decay and food insecurity by way of urban agriculture. We use a number of sustainable growing techniques ranging from organic soil to hydroponics to aquaponics.
Also known as a closed loop system, it allows growers to continually recycle the same water with the help from fish. Forbes and his team use generic hardy goldfish. The water his plants don't suck up is collected back into big fish tanks at the end of the growing bed after the plants purify the water from everything toxic to the fish. The fish's restroom waste then makes the water rich in nutrients the plants need, allowing Good Life Growing to avoid all synthetic fertilizers, and it's pumped back up to the plants in a symbiotic loop. This saves money for Good Life Growing and is beneficial to the environment.
Essentially recreating the natural phenomena you see in a lake, river, pond, or stream.
They're beneficial to the health of their residents too, the citizens of North St. Louis.
We started this right around the time that there was a lot of civil unrest here in St. Louis. A lot of disenfranchisement, ultimately stemming from people not having dignifying, consistent work and not being able to be afforded the same opportunities that myself and the other founders had.
Good Life Growing teaches volunteers about sustainable agriculture, and they'll take on paid apprentices who work with them to learn the trade and gain a U.S. Department of Labor certification of a grow trainee, allowing them to take advantage of entry-level jobs in our growing ag and ag tech sector.
And along the way, they learn a living wage salary, We've seen young people from different walks of life look forward to career paths and things outside of what they see every day. We go into school systems and other community organizations for enrichment programming.
In addition to selling their produce and microgreens to many area restaurants, they also donate a large portion of it.
Almost 40% of our food goes to community organizations, institutions like schools and churches. It goes to a lot of food pantries, and we're also sponsored by BJC Hospital System to support and facilitate pop-up produce stands in North St. Louis City communities so that folks that otherwise wouldn't have access to a traditional farm stand can get locally grown food available.
They have found yet another way to combat that food swamp and food insecurity. In addition to earning a 2018 Arch Grant, Good Life Growing also won further validation by winning the Old North Storefront Competition. Through that win, they'll be opening up a sustainable grocery, Catty Corner to Crown Candy Kitchen, in June 2019. In addition to selling sustainable agriculture products and some staples, they'll also be serving ready-to-go healthy food options from Kitchen Culture and Honey and Thyme. And if that isn't enough, they are in construction on a second indoor year-round growing space. They will be located near the riverfront on Lumiere Place Boulevard. The Greencubator, as they call it, will provide year-round space for more agricultural production, classes, and distribution of their products.
Outside of just the need to nourish yourself and intake food, to specifically treat food as medicine is critical. I've seen it firsthand where we've had people with high blood pressure just start coming here on Sundays and supplementing their diet, and they've reported back that blood pressure goes down. We've seen people start to lose weight by just changing their diet and working a little bit outside. So it was part economics, part passion that just came together and made sense.
I'm Aiden Livingston, the CEO and founder of Thermo AI. Most people don't realize, but currently power plants operate at 33% efficiency, meaning two-thirds of the energy in the system is wasted. We've developed an artificial intelligence that can optimize real-time production, saving millions in fuel and drastically reducing emissions. We're originally out of New York, and I love New York, but ultimately that's not where our customers are, and we need to be closer to our customers. So that's going to be all throughout the Midwest and the South. They have a lot more of the manufacturing and production. They're the ones that are most impacted by industrial pollution. Near the metal manufacturing, cement manufacturing, even in Missouri, the energy still comes from coal. So those are definitely activities we can have the largest impact on. We started the project down in South America. We were originally in Startup Chile, a government program, and the industrial pollution in some of those areas is unreal. I mean, I was developing asthma-like symptoms after only a few months there. What we're offering is an artificial intelligence that can understand all the facets that go into combustion, because there's actually millions of different things that can influence it, from where the fuel is from, what the weather outside is, what the actual composition of the fuel is. That's going to change the exact chemical reaction. So what you end up seeing is these graphs that kind of go like this, because it's always trying to achieve efficiency retroactively with what just happened. By training the system on what the perfect settings are in any condition ahead of time, we're able to get that efficiency up at a much higher level with less variation. So basically, we can optimize the combustion process, which saves on fuel as well as reduces the emissions. Potential impact from this, I mean, for all the well-meaningness of these different initiatives, I mean, buying an electric car, increasing the industrial efficiency at one power plant, even 1%, is the same as taking 288,000 cars off the road. The exciting part about the machine learning component of this, the kind of collective learning. Every new facility that we work with has the experience of all the other facilities, so that the benefit that you can get collectively is so much larger than each individual. Even the most trained expert at one facility could never match having the information and the understanding, the experience of 10,000 facilities, for instance. So the most natural first audience is energy companies, simply because 50 to 70% of their overall cost is fuel. So anything we can do to increase their fuel efficiency is going to have a huge impact. Most power facilities could be saving tens of millions of dollars annually once this is fully automated and online. But naturally, we can help anybody who has thermal combustion component to their production. We don't make money until they make money. We take a percent of what we save them in fuel savings. There's no risk to them. Industry 4.0 is right around the corner, so they need to be ready for that anyways. And we can help them drastically reduce their emissions, increase their fuel savings, increase the lifespan of their expensive industrial equipment. So there's really no reason to say no.
They may only be 10 years old, but these Clayton Kids Zone students are already learning about adult career choices.
I think it opens the doors for a lot of kids, because so many times I think, you know, kids have a one-track mind of, you know, they see what their parents do, or they see teachers, or, you know, the kind of typical jobs that you think about, police, firefighter, things like that, and this really opens up kids to a lot of different careers and different ideas and different things that, you know, they may not be exposed to on an everyday basis.
That's exactly what Allison Bischoff and Jessica Gordon were hoping for when they founded Rozzi Learning Company. They provide programs like this one for teachers that include interactive videos and hands-on adventures, giving students an idea of the technical skills needed in various careers, especially those in STEM fields. And these programs start early, even in preschool.
Rozzi came from Jessica, our CEO, being a preschool teacher, and she saw that there wasn't a lot of career discussion in elementary school, let alone in preschool. And there's so much research showing that kids really need to be introduced earlier on, because when they're introduced in high school, it's really too late.
Before creating Rozzi, the duo published a children's book based on science. Maggie the Magnifying Glass is the story of a young girl who makes observations to solve problems. The company expanded from there and took the name of the teacher in their book, Miss Rozzi, named to honor Rosalind Franklin. Franklin was instrumental, alongside Watson and Crick, in finding the structure of DNA, but was left off of the Nobel Prize because she was a woman. Rozzi Learning Company originally focused on increasing girls' interest in STEM. Now, they serve all kids and have added several more characters to their educational programs.
So in career adventures, the kids will be introduced to different characters like Whitney the wildlife specialist or Eli the engineer. And these are cartoon characters who will be in these videos and taking them through these career adventures. And at the end, they get to do that hands-on activity.
These characters and videos are thanks in large part to a $50,000 equity-free Arch Grant Rozzi won in 2017. They followed up that honor by winning the locally based catapult competition.
Earning an Arch Grant means that we can take some more risks with our company. Right now, we're in the transition phase of moving our product into its new iteration of career adventures with the videos and the cartoons. And so by having the Arch Grant money, we feel like we have some cushion to spend money on this pivot with our product, and we can feel comfortable doing that without having to, you know, risk going under.
Right now, Rozzi works with more than 400 preschool, elementary, and middle schools in more than 40 states. They hope to expand even further to spark kids' interests in careers and give teachers a new way to teach STEM, such as the project Tyler Kearns is working on, exploring being an architect.
I think Rozzi is a great program. I really enjoy what they're doing, and I know our staff really like it. Like I said, the ease of them using it, and our kids are really enjoying it. So it's a great way to incorporate some of those STEAM ideas into our after-school program. A lot of them like looking at the different job aspects. That's a unique way. Instead of just doing like a science experiment or making slime or just doing this or that, as far as your, you know, your typical science projects, they're actually getting to see how what they're learning can apply, and, you know, things that they can grow up to be.
I'm Leon Doyle. I'm the CEO of Wi-Fi Plug. Wi-Fi Plug is an app-controlled smart plug. What that basically means is you can plug any appliance into it and make it smart. Take a lamp, for example. plug that in, download our app, and you can use it with Siri, Alexa, Google. Hey Siri, turn the lights on. Imagine plugging a Wi-Fi plug into the back of an extension cable. You would have your TV, your cable, your DVR, surround sound all on one. So four or five appliances coming out of one plug. It starts to learn how much energy you're using on standby. It knows when you're in standby because when you're not in standby, the energy levels pop up. And when you are in standby, they drop. Those standby lights on your appliances, your TV, your coffee machine, your cable, everything like that, that is consuming power all the time, even when you're asleep, even when you're out of the house. And so our plug and our technology learns your routines. And so when you're out or when you're asleep, it just shuts it down. And then it turns it all back on 5 minutes before you get home, 10 minutes before you wake up. So your day is not affected by this, but your savings are. Typically a house with standby appliances, it costs you $200 a year. Just with that little red dot on your TV, your cable, your media center, $200 is completely wasted. So our plug is able to pick up and detect through the energy meter inside it that it's wasting energy, that you're not watching it. It's got geofencing on your phone. It knows you're out of the house. It knows you're the last person out. So if you've got a family, you can have a sharing account. It switches it off and saves you that consumption. So it says, hey, saved you $6 this month. That's it.
Hello everyone, welcome back.
Welcome
Please take
back,
a second,
everyone.
Find your seat, or find someone else's seat. There's plenty for the taking. Gene and Roy, I see you over there.
Oh, where are they?
I'm sorry, if we take time for you guys to talk to everyone you know tonight, Lisa and I won't be back home until 11 p.m. That's way past our bedtime. Someone's saying louder. Who's calling me out?
Louder.
Tell me when.
There's Sherry.
Good? Jerry?
Hello, everyone.
All right.
Everyone's just having too much fun. Welcome back to the Arch Grants 10X event. Is everyone having fun?
Folks, tonight Lisa and I are here to share a uniquely Arch Grant story. And this story has it all. It's got St. Louis, entrepreneurship, COVID pandemics, low points, high fashion, hope, despair, true love, and of course, Arch Grants. Yes, this story has everything except wizards and dragons and an HBO budget. And we've only got 5 minutes to tell it per game, so we're gonna dive in. Our story begins once upon a time in a town called University City. That's where I grew up. I was a product of St. Louis.
Yeah.
Yes. Woo! I was a product of St. Louis and U City public schools, went away to Stanford for undergrad, and after graduating in 2016, came back to St. Louis and took the traditional path into technology entrepreneurship. I ran for city council as a 22-year-old. And after 100 days knocking on 5,000 doors and wearing a hole in my only pair of dress shoes, I reached election day and got 46% of the vote. And let me tell you, close does not feel very good in the age of social media where everyone who ever knew you existed just knows that you lost the political thing. So there I am trying to pick myself up from this very public failure and find my new start. Meanwhile, all my friends from Stanford have gotten jobs at companies like Facebook and Google and Morgan Stanley. And at the time, all my professional relationships were back on the West Coast. As a 22-year-old, the pressure to move back was immense. But on a whim, I went to an event at WashU, Startup Connection. And as I'm walking past a booth, I overhear this entrepreneur pitching his startup. And he's talking about how they use media and data to help companies reach their customers, do marketing differently, build an audience, and I'm hooked. I knew right then and there that I wanted to work with him. Well, Jonathan Allen was at Startup Connection that night because in 2016, an Arch Grant brought him from New York to St. Louis. And he's here with us in the audience tonight.
Woo! Go, Jonathan! Woo!
At a moment when my life could have led me away from St. Louis, because of Arch Grants, there was a job waiting for me here in my hometown. And not just any job. A career working alongside a founder, building a startup, learning the skills that would help me start my own company, several years later.
And as Luke was starting his career, I was ending mine in corporate finance to start a handbag line. My traditional Asian parents really love that. I came from generations of accountants, and here I am building a handbag line. But it wasn't just any handbag line. It was the start of Lux & Nyx. And at Lux & Nyx, we equip high-achieving women with the tools they need to stay organized and look and feel amazing. And how many high-achieving women in here is a Lux & Nyx customer? Raise your hand, please. And raise the hands for them. Oh, there's Andre right there. So we had a super unique sales strategy. We sold across 16 different cities, had a database full of in-person sales events. Sales had grown 200% year over year, and I won Arch Grants in 2019, and I was ready to go and scale in 2020. In 2020, we were at ready to scale full nation, every single city, meeting our customers face-to-face, in person, and less than 6 feet apart. So COVID took my business from hero to zero overnight. And during that time, the $50,000 from Arch Grants was not just a grant. It became my runway to rebuild. And not only did that happen, they also reached back out and did three things for me. First, they connected us with entrepreneurs, many of whom are in here tonight as well, and we were able to bond over Zoom and then talk about how we weren't alone and that everything's going to be okay. And it was good to know that you weren't alone during that time frame. And second, they provided mentors. Ronak Sheth, Arch Grants class of 2012, the original Arch Grants class, he's sitting in the audience tonight as well. He was an entrepreneur in resident at Arch Grants, and he was a key mentor to me during a very pivotal time in the career of Lux & Nyx. And then third, they connected me with leaders from the local region, such as Zundra from Centene, and Bill from Purina. There's Bill, who's also in the audience tonight. Thank you guys so much. As I rebuilt Lux & Nyx into a brand new strategy, now we do corporate gifting with our products for high-achieving women to show them we appreciate them and then root for their success along the way. So we still have a website, don't worry. Everyone can still buy Lux & Nyx products on the website. So Arch Grants started with a grant, but it didn't end there. They've supported me to today. As Lux & Nyx grew through a new sales strategy, we're starting to hire again. We grew sales by 300% year over year, and we've sold to high-achieving women across 26 different countries.
Arch Grants gave me my first job out of college and my first step towards entrepreneurship.
Arch Grants gave me a runway to rebuild, mentorship, and community when I needed it the most, as well as my first customers in a new sales channel.
And Arch Grants also gave us each other. Four years, 5 months, and 24 days ago, but who's counting? I went to the birthday party of a fellow Arch Grants founder whose company got an Arch Grant 1 year before mine did.
And I went to the same birthday party.
I looked up from my plate of sushi and saw that woman who had been blasting me with handbag ads on social media for the last 3 months.
Yeah, it's true. So instead of asking me on a date, he asked if I wanted to hang out that weekend and work.
Four years later, we've never really stopped hanging out on the weekend and working.
We went through highs and lows and a COVID quarantine.
And ever the accountant at heart, Lisa pointed out that we should probably get married so we could start saving money on our taxes.
smart idea. Ever the romantic, he picked the perfect moment, and we got married May 25th of this year. 4 years to the date. Yeah. 4 years to the date of that birthday of the Arch Grants founder.
One of my favorite things about St. Louis is that we are a city of trees. Growing up in U City, I feel this especially, these 100-year-old oaks and maple and sweet gum. And the mind-blowing thing about having a city of trees is that some pig-headed person had to plant and nurture them for 50 years before we get to enjoy the shade. Well, 10 years ago, people, many in this room, took a chance on Arch Grants when it was just an idea. 6 years ago, an Arch Grants founder took a chance on me, gave me my first shot at a real job at a startup, taught me the skills to build. Today, my own startup, Clever Real Estate, employs almost 100 people, has helped almost 20,000 families all over the country buy or sell homes, and has helped them save over $140 million on real estate fees. And one day, Lisa and I will be sitting next to you, watching someone who got their start at Clever take this stage to talk about the company they're building in St. Louis.
Companies don't grow in isolation. They grow in fertile soil. We're here tonight only by the grace of our friends, our mentors, and each other, a community. And because of people who 10 years ago believed in a vision of the future. And we're here as two voices of a generation, a growing generation, to say thank you. Thank you to those who planted those seeds long before they could enjoy the shade. And to say, keep going. This forest is growing. I think we're supposed to introduce the next video that it's about to show, which will showcase, he's creeping back on stage, to showcase more Arch Grants founders and their inspirational stories. Please enjoy. Thank you.
We built Label Insight to have a truly great product, and we wanted to provide transparency around product data, pretty much food you eat or anything you put on your body in cosmetics. I really like that kind of company, and St. Louis really helped us grow that kind of company. Arch Grants was really the catalyst with the 50,000 grant money. We went to a business accelerator with 50,000, then another $4 million Series A, then another $10 million Series B, and then a $20 million Series C.
In 2015, we were three students and an idea. We barely had any data to demonstrate that our idea would work, but we had a passion to develop and improve healthcare for patients with gastrointestinal disease. Our technology leveraged RNA-based biomarkers in stool samples that could be used to develop non-invasive diagnostics that could better monitor, treat, and diagnose gastrointestinal disease.
In 2017, we were based out of Madison, Wisconsin, and Arch Grants was the catalyst that moved us to St. Louis. The $50,000 non-dilutive grant allowed us to hire our first employees, establish a scalable and sustainable infrastructure, and it allowed us to get some snacks to bring talent to the company.
Early 2020, we were laser focused on helping Black-owned businesses grow by bringing their products into more and more consumers' hands. I was packing every box in my living room of my apartment in Charlotte, and we were looking for a forever home for our business.
I was in my last year of law school at Georgetown. I was at a crossroads. I didn't know if I was gonna go the traditional route or see if this business had legs, and when we got an arts grant, it was a no-brainer.
Today, I'm still in St. Louis. St. Louis is my home. I'm glad to build my legacy and my family's legacy here, so much so that I joined another Arch Grants company inclusively. At the greatest time, it's the building stages of the company.
We have over 50 full-time employees today. Over 70% are still based here in St. Louis, where our headquarters is. We've raised over $60 million of equity capital. Maybe most importantly, we've taken the concept for genoscopy, the idea that we could non-invasively detect, monitor, help guide treatment for gastrointestinal diseases. We've taken our first product all the way from idea to the cusp of commercialization.
Today, we are a team of 168 full-time employees at TCARE. We are providing a technology solution that understands, through leveraging AI and other tools, the right resource at the right time, right place for families to take care of their loved ones so they don't end up burning out.
Fast forward to today, we're a full-time team of four. We've worked with some incredible companies, CarMax, Centene, Capital One, to create unforgettable gifting experiences full of products from Black-owned businesses.
The St. Louis region has grown dramatically over the last 10 years, in no small part because of Arch Grants. I think St. Louis is a great place to achieve the quintessential American dream, which is really to make it big.
I think we could become a place where people actively go, where they know that they can find funding, they can find talent, they can find innovative research, they can find key opinion leaders, they can find everything they need to develop a really successful company here.
My hope for St. Louis is that in the next 10 years, instead of us pushing the value of what St. Louis can bring to the table, we now have this gravitational pull where all startups want to come to St. Louis for access to their community and all the resources that they need to grow their company.
When people think and talk about startups, usually the conversation begins with the coast. But I think in 10 years, if St. Louis really becomes what it can be, St. Louis will be a part of the beginning of that conversation. And you can't have a startup ecosystem conversation without thinking of St. Louis first. That would be my hope for the city and where we head.
My hope for St. Louis 10 years from now is that we're not saying St. Louis has the bones of or the potential to be a great city, but that it is a great city. and that when you go to other places across the country and you say you live in St. Louis, they understand why you would choose to build a company or build a life in this city.
Didn't those folks do a great job? There's a lot of hands making this event happen. Lisa and I have the simplest honor of the night, but also one of the greatest, which is we want to welcome to the stage a mentor, a friend, an inspiration to a lot of folks in the community, and above all, a hard worker who rolls up his sleeves every day, and for many years has rolled up his sleeves to make the magic of Arch Grants, everything that we're seeing happen. With honest work. So please join us in welcoming to the stage the Executive Director of Arch Grants, Gabe Angieri.
Before I start, first I want to thank Lisa and Luke for doing a phenomenal job tonight. Let's hear it for them. I also need to thank Richard Tao, who was called out earlier by John, but he's our creative director for tonight's event, and I've had the profound privilege of working with Richard for the last 7 galas, and he pours his heart and soul into these events, and without him, you wouldn't want to see the one I designed. Let's just put it that way. So please join me in thanking Richard. And of course, our board of directors, without whom Arch Grants would not exist. They're core to everything we do. I would like to ask each of you to stand and be recognized. Please, Arch Grants board. And last, but certainly not least, our sponsors for tonight's event, who, along with our community partners and program funders, make everything Arch Grants does possible and allows us to keep innovating and raising the bar year after year. Thank you to all of our sponsors tonight. Hello, I'm Gabe. It's great to be with you, back in person after so long apart. The impact Arch Grants has catalyzed over the past 10 years is significant, but it goes so much further than the video you just saw, and there's so much more to celebrate. But I'm not here tonight to talk to you about the last decade of success. I'm here to talk about the future and this community's power to fundamentally transform St. Louis through Arch Grants and the entrepreneurs that we support. At our core, we started as a talent development agency. Our client, St. Louis. Our targeted talent, innovative founders of high-growth startups. Like any good recruiter, we promote all that's good with this region. World-class museums and cultural institutions, cutting-edge science and research centers. We also have incredible universities. WashU, SLU are here tonight, thank you. Championship sports teams, nationally acclaimed restaurants, and so much more. But we also have many challenges that hold our region back. Population decline, economic trouble, population flight, systemic racism, crime. These issues aren't unique to St. Louis, far from it. But what is unique to St. Louis is Arch Grants. You see, we've grown beyond just being a talent recruitment agency. The founders we work with, and the newest founders you've either met or will meet tonight, aren't just looking for a place to succeed. They're looking for a place from which to lead. At Arch Grants, we are constantly, relentlessly asking ourselves how we can better support, attract, retain these entrepreneurial leaders in St. Louis. But we also ask how they can contribute to making our region a better place. How founders like Doug and Danielle, Erica and Andrew, Dheeraj and Ali, how they can help lead St. Louis to realize its full potential, to a future that they envision. That's the reason we're awarding over $2 million in non-dilutive funding tonight. And we can only do that because of this community's support. And because we at Arch Grants have proven that we can drive real economic impact through this fairly unique model of a nonprofit funding early stage startups. Over the past 10 years, as you saw in the video, our companies have created over 2,700 jobs in St. Louis, paying out over $120 million in wages over the past 10 years, $36 million in wages in last year alone, even in the midst of a pandemic. They've generated over $500 million in capital, or in revenue, excuse me. And they've raised over $640 million in growth capital. We are proud of those numbers and know that so many of you in this room are responsible for making them possible. This is your impact. And I can promise you we're not going to slow down. That's why we increased our grant awards this year. It's why we launched the Growth Grants Program last year. And it's why we intentionally sought out and secured funding to fund companies from underrepresented groups to make sure that our entrepreneurial community better reflects our community's rich diversity. Thank you to NHTSA and Bank of America, particularly. Moving forward, Arch Grants will activate this critical mass of founders we've built, and we won't stop pushing the envelope on how we can drive deeper, more significant impact in St. Louis. Arch Grants symbolizes confidence and boldness in a city that too often tempers and minimizes its potential. The power of Lisa and Luke and hundreds of other Arch Grants companies and founders, it's not just in the jobs they create or the wealth they accumulate. It's the disruptive way they think and the way they take risks in pursuit of a goal. They believe they won't fail, so even in the face of apparent failure, they will eventually realize success. Ladies and gentlemen, that is a significant asset that we can leverage in this region. Our supporters invest their time, energy, philanthropic dollars into this organization because they believe, as we do, that the best is yet to come for this city. But it won't happen without intentionality, effort, and each of you. For the new startups you'll meet shortly, receiving an Arch Grant isn't an end point. It's the beginning of how they'll experience St. Louis in a new way. Arch Grants is the neural network that our founders interface with when they come to us to seek mentors, to recruit talent, to raise investment dollars, attract customers, work with professional service firms, and gain research partnerships. We are the pathways to you, to this community, and to an entire network of resources around the country. 10 years in, we have directly incentivized hundreds of companies, hundreds of founders to grow their startups in St. Louis. We've invested in their visions so they can help us realize ours. They are natural change agents who are creating futures that others can only imagine. They put everything they have on the line in pursuit of something better, and they aren't willing to fail. Think about that boldness multiplied by hundreds more Arch Grants founders in the coming 10 years. For me, that's a thrilling future to imagine. The next 10 years of Arch Grants will be defined by more than the KPIs we track, the amount of funding we give out in a given year, or the number of companies we attract or retain. Arch Grants, this entire community, will be measured by how well we leverage this insanely talented, impressive group of founders in building a better future for our city. They are primed to help solve our most pressing problems, and they will ultimately make this a more attractive place for startup founders, high growth companies, and companies of all sizes to base and grow. Thank you for being here tonight. Thank you for your support. Thank you for joining us to champion this bold new generation of leaders for our city. Thank you. It's now my pleasure to introduce a good friend and Arch Grants founder, CEO of Flipstick, Akeem Shannon, to help present the 2022 cohort of Arch Grants companies.
Good evening. How are we doing this evening? They gave me a mic because they know I don't like to stand still. But listen, folks, you know, I am honored to be here with you all this evening. I have the pleasure of introducing the next cohort of Arch Grants. But before I do, I want to tell you a little story. A story from a long time ago called Monday of this week. On Monday of this week, I went down to Austin, Texas, to an event called Afrotech. And I had a little rendezvous with an old friend of mine. Some of you guys may know that we were featured on Shark Tank in 2020, right before we received an Arch Grant. And on Monday, I happened to run into my old friend, Mark Cuban. And at the time, he didn't make an investment, and I wanted to remind him of that fact. I said, you know, Mark, in 2020, you told me I had the best rap in the history of Shark Tank ever, but you also told me my sales sucked. And to be honest, they did. I had only made $1,500 the month before I went on Shark Tank. But I told Mark, ask me how much we made last month. He asked, and I said, we made 150 grand last month. And then I said, hey, Mark, the last time I saw you, we were selling flipsticks in a kiosk in a mall in St. Louis. Ask me where we sell flipsticks now. And I said, we sell flipsticks in Target nationwide and Best Buy nationwide and AT&T and T-Mobile. And just like you, the crowd went wild. They absolutely loved it. But over the course of the next few days, people kept coming up to me asking me, wow, that was amazing. How did you do it? And do you know what my answer was? I did it with the support of St. Louis. What I didn't get from a shark, I was able to get from St. Louis. What they didn't know was that in 2020, when we didn't have a shark to help us get ready for Shark Tank, I sent a text to Gabe late at night, and I was like, Gabe, we're going to be on Shark Tank in 2 weeks. I need money, and I need it fast. And Gabe came through. What they didn't know is a year ago when Target said, hey, we want to put you in all these stores, I text Gabe, and I was like, Gabe, we need to figure something out. We need to figure it fast. And he introduced me to investors. What they didn't know is 2 weeks ago when QVC said they wanted to put us on air, I said, yo, Gabe, we need some of that growth grant money. We need it fast. What they didn't know is that I had the backing of not just Arch Grants, but all of you here in St. Louis. And that exponential growth that we were able to achieve was because of the support we had right here from the beginning. So they told me my time is up, and what I want to tell you all tonight is I'm so excited for the next cohort to be able to experience the support that I experienced once I won an Arch Grant. So without hesitation, I would like to introduce to you the 2022 cohort of Arch Grants.
My name is Nacho Walden, and I am the CEO and founder of Balancetopia, where we take your health goals or symptoms and turn them into nutrient-dense meals prepared by us, delivered to you, ready to heat and eat in a matter of 2 minutes.
Hi, my name is Asha Owens. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Best Fit. And at Best Fit, we're modernizing the social safety net to help people access the help they need before it's too late. We work specifically with social service providers, nonprofits, and community-based organizations to connect low-income residents to federal programs like SNAP, TANF, and utilities assistance.
Hi, everyone. I'm Mohammed, founder of Karma. We're a mobile app for car owners to get correct car repair fast and fair. We connect our users with highly trusted car repair shops in the local area to get the best deal on car repairs and maintenance services. Car owners request service in the Karma app, which we send to car partner shops nearby who make offers on their service requests. Our mission is to create efficient pricing and eliminate scams for all auto repairs nationwide and globally.
Hi, my name is Samuel J. Cummings III, CEO of Dataplan.
Hi, my name is Mitlesh Kumar, CTO and co-founder of Dataplan.
And we have built the world's first sentient analytics platform, helping companies grow and retain their customer base, empowering customer success teams to become data-driven, leaders to execute like never before, and admins to never have to build a report again.
DentScore is a digital health company that enables people to navigate their dental care needs so they can live healthier and happier lives. Our application is a dental symptom checker, which provides treatment decision support so people can receive high quality, more personalized, and affordable dental care.
Hi, I'm Brittany Dwyer, founder of Disco, the digital platform for exploring, booking, and managing group events and experiences. We strongly believe that gathering together through group events enables meaningful connections, but for the consumers planning and the vendor businesses they're seeking, the process has not been digitized and it's extremely frustrating. But Disco is your one-stop shop for finding those creative, local, curated options.
The Fan Cafe is a Filipino barbecue pop-up restaurant and consumer goods package company in St. Louis.
You can also find our packaged goods like our longanisa and Filipino barbecue sauces and marinades in over 67 grocery stores throughout Missouri and Southern Illinois. The Fat and Calf is all about representation. We want to bring Filipino food in every household throughout the United States.
My name is Abesh, and I'm the founder and CEO of Flora. We provide an entire ecosystem to take the guesswork out of plant care and help save as many plants as possible. Flora provides an app for both Android and iOS, and a device called the Flora Pod that measures moisture, light, humidity, temperature, and much more to tell you exactly what you need to save your plants and gardens.
Hi, I'm Emory Rains, CEO and founder of Grab My Bag, where we're making it easier for travelers to get their checked baggage. Grab My Bag is a luggage delivery service from airport baggage claim to the traveler's requested location. Travelers can book a grab on our website, and we will dispatch our grabbers to grab, secure, and deliver your bag directly to where you want. No more waiting for baggage.
Happy Teal is an environmental modeling company that target at companies in the agriculture value chain. So what we do is to use the scientifically rigorous models, integrating with all kinds of measurements, quantify every farmland's carbon emission, nutrient management, and water implications.
Hey, I'm Joe, and I'm the CEO and co-founder of Hive. We make smart sensors for IV lines that can tell doctors when their home IV patients are taking their medicine and when they're not. That lets them intervene earlier to help get them back on track and improve clinical outcomes.
Hi, I'm Gavin Pringle, founder and CEO of Jacapa. We're solving the number one reason why people are fired: soft skills. Soft skills cost businesses $30,000 per employee each year. We help businesses improve their productivity and decrease turnover.
Hi, I'm Peter. I'm Drew, and we're the co-founders of Mars Farm. We put ag tech into the hands of teachers through agriculture education programs like the FFA. Our platform allows the next generation of farmers to learn the technical skills they need to feed a changing world.
Hi, my name is Brianna Arps, and I am the founder and CEO of Mudo, the home of clean, luxury fragrances designed to help you flaunt how you feel. We're rooted in the scientific connection between scent, memory, and emotion, and we do this all without any alcohol, water, or dye.
Hi, my name is Michael Alite,
My name is Kendrick Barefoot.
And the name of our company is Novell. Novell is the first dating app with no profiles and no swipes. So how it works, we are a video first dating app that uses machine learning to match our users. And we are designed specifically for Generation Z young adults.
My name is Kwame Liddell, and I'm the founder and CEO of Nutrible. Every day, 10,000 people turn 65, but there aren't enough doctors and nurses to take care of them. So at Nutrible, we provide one-on-one care management virtually and self-service medically tailored meals to keep them happy at home through our network of caregivers like nurses, doctors, and social workers.
Peppermint is a consumer healthcare brand focused on mobility. We're transforming the category of brandless and clinical-looking medical equipment into beautiful exercise and recovery products. Through relentless brand building, product design, and engineering, we're building products for people, not patients.
I'm Kelly Robson. I'm the founder of PIV2 Digital Learning. We're an ed tech company that specializes in creating e-learning experiences specifically for the healthcare industry. And there's about 22 million people working in the healthcare sector for about 18% of our U.S. GDP. And it's very difficult to train those people remotely. That's what we specialize in.
Hi, my name is Shanai, and I'm the co-founder of Querytel. And we provide independent businesses with retail analytics as well as store automation solutions. And we provide these companies with a state-of-the-art platform to reach more customers in-store as well as online, because happy customers means more business.
Hi, my name is Tyler Richards. I'm the founder of UFAB. Circuit boards are central to our modern society. However, designing and manufacturing circuit boards is a slow, cumbersome, and expensive process. Not anymore. With our patent-pending technology, designers, creators, and makers can manufacture circuit boards on their own quickly and efficiently.
I'm Matthew Barnard, CEO and founder of Upgrade Energy. We make aerospace batteries for UAVs and small aircraft. We make ultralight battery systems which have more power density than any other battery in the industry. Our patent-pending product is changing the world one step at a time right here in St. Louis, Missouri.
Wayfair believes that knowledge is a superpower. Our knowledge-sharing platform gives libraries, schools, and nonprofits the ability to elevate and gamify their underused resources. This way, knowledge seekers can find exactly what they need when they need it. By making knowledge accessible to all, now everyone has that superpower.
Hi, I'm Michelle Medeiros, co-founder and chief customer officer of Wingspan.
And I'm James Barbieri, co-founder and CEO of Wingspan, and we are expanding what's possible with drones. We created an airplane that fits in a backpack. It flies 5 times longer with 10 times more aerial intelligence solutions on board.
If you're not already on your feet, get on your feet! Welcome the 2022 cohort of Arch Grants! Get your photos now before you can't get them later. All right, thank you guys. Woo! And with that, I think we're on to the next thing. Congratulations, guys.
All right, folks, let's give it up one more time for the 2022 cohort of Arch Grants Companies. This is great. They gave us notes for this part. Let me check. What are we here to do? Oh, this is the 10 minutes that's going to set the next 10 years of Arch Grants off on the right track. And folks, this is where Lisa and I really need your help. This is the part where we need you to pull a muscle. If you're only doing what's comfortable, we aren't doing enough tonight for the future of the city. And you won't be doing enough for me and Lisa as well, because Gabe said that if we can't leave this stage having raised $100,000, number one, we're going to be doing dishes in the back tonight.
We're not good at doing dishes.
I promise you, no one wants that. And number two, next year they're going to go hire a professional from the county fairs used to selling cows. And we don't want a professional either. For Lisa and I tonight, this is personal. So we want to thank Arch Grants for giving us the chance to come up here and set the next 10 years up for success. So Lisa's going to explain how this works. Babe, take them away.
All right, guys. Well, we're going to play a game. There's two rules to this, two ways you can partner with Arch Grants. One, you can fill out the information on the back of these paddles in the front of your seat. Everyone should have one. And when you hear the level you like to support, a volunteer will come by and collect your note and donation and collect your paddle. You can also give via text message, text ARCH to the with the amount, and donate to 91999. It's also on the back here as well, and then follow that link that's back to you. It's super simple. And then, another part of this game, for every $250, a diamond will pop up on the screen. So 100,000, that's what? Do the math, babe.
We need 400 diamonds filling in a mosaic of companies Arch Grants has funded, and we need your help to make it happen.
And we're gonna blow this up.
And tonight,
we're not going to do dishes tonight.
There's two folks, Paul and Roger Riney, who've kicked things off by promising to match the first $50,000 that we raise here tonight. Thank you so much. Paul and Roger Riney, for paying it forward. And we want to kick things off tonight by seeing if we can match. Is there someone in the audience tonight who will help us match Paul and Roger Riney's generous gift? And there's only one 10-year anniversary for Arch Grants. So tonight we need your help to make this a big one. So first opening bid, is anyone ready to meet Paul and Roger Riney with a $50,000 donation to Arch Grants tonight? That's a big number. That was a number that got Lisa through a COVID pandemic. I know, because I was working next to her 16 hours a day.
Yes.
There were a lot of Zoom calls. We need to divide and conquer. There's two of us here tonight. So if Lisa and I can each walk away with someone who's ready to step to the table and make a $25,000 donation, we can match Roger and Paula Riney. Does anyone have Lisa? Anyone want to help Lisa stay out of doing the dishes in the back there? Do we have a donation for $25,000? Will anyone raise a paddle for $25,000? We've got one! Thank you so much!
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Someone's coming over. If you don't mind standing up, we'd love to do one more round of applause. And then I would love to know if anyone else... If anyone else is going to help me out tonight, because I definitely don't want to be stuck doing dishes without my wife. So if anyone else is ready to step forward and make a donation, let's see if we can meet Roger and Paula Riney tonight. Is there anyone else ready to make a $25,000 donation? Do we have any other paddles heading up? Any other paddles? Anyone who's thinking about it? Who's teetering on the edge? I'm not going to make eye contact with this table over here.
Okay, I think I need to read some stats here. Let me pull out my, I actually did some work back in my accounting days. So did you guys know that there's $14 million that were awarded to 230 companies since 2012, and they've generated $500 million in revenue? So $25,000 funds $1 million in revenue, as well as 5 full-time jobs in the St. Louis region.
Can you tell that Lisa used to be an accountant? Will anyone stand for a $15,000 donation? Do we have anyone at the $15,000 threshold? If you heard a story tonight that connected with you, if you met a founder out there before we all came in, will anyone stand to donate $15,000 to Arch Grants tonight? Do we have any donations at $15,000? If you heard a story tonight that rang true for you, if Arch Grants brought a company here that you personally invested in, do we have anyone for $15,000? I'm going to go down and do some real complex arithmetic here. Folks, if we can get 10 people to raise their paddles for $10,000, we will have raised $100,000 tonight. They taught me that back at Stanford. Do we have anyone for $10,000? If we can have 10 folks raise their paddles,
woo!
We've got one.
Behind the right.
Thank you so much.
Another
we've got two.
Table. Three.
We've got a third.
Come on, fourth.
Thank you so much. Keep that applause fourth? Going. We've got a fourth. Thank you so much.
Guys.
I was sitting in the stage when the first company I ever worked for got an Arch Grants, and remember what it was like to watch a founder doing this. It's pretty amazing to sit on the other side. Do we have a fifth who will come in for $10,000? We do. John, thank you so much.
$10,000.
$50,000 at the $10,000 donation level. Thank you all so much for your generosity. I know there's some folks from my team here tonight from Clever, and we've got another 10,000. Thank you for kicking all of this off.
All right, $10,000 funds 2 employees in the St. Louis region. $10,000.
We've got another one.
Another one.
Thank you.
I've lost count.
I think that brings us up to $95,000 raised tonight.
Oh my God, one more.
If anyone wants to put us over the top, you can have Lisa and I wipe some sweat from our brows and know that we can actually see you at the cocktail hour in 3 minutes here. Is there one more person who will raise a paddle tonight for a $10,000 donation to Arch Grants? We do. Thank you so much, Jim. It's an honor to have you tonight. That's $105,000. Let's do a round of applause for the whole room.
One goal. All right. Thank you, guys. We don't have to do the dishes tonight, but we want to up the ante. Luke, do you want to tell them what's going to happen next?
Well, we doubled down with Gabe. We said if we can't raise $100,000, we'll take care of all the dishes for the amazing community that came out tonight. But if we can hit $125,000, Gabe is going to be the one on dish duty this evening. So we really need your help here in the home stretch as we get down to the $5,000 donations. If you want to step up tonight and show support for the next 10 years of Arch Grants, because of the last 10 years, because of people who over the last 10 years have come into this room and stood up, Lisa and I are here tonight. There's another generation of folks working at St. Louis startups seeing the generosity of this community, and I want them to feel as inspired as I was 5, 6 years ago, as excited as I was to come up on this stage and try to support a cause that creates a lot of opportunity. Will anyone stand up for $5,000 for Arch Grants and the St. Louis ecosystem? Thank you, sir!
FYI.
Is that Ronick?
Yeah, that's Ronick.
Ronick! Let's do another round of applause for Ronick, entrepreneur in residence.
2012.
a startup founder who won an award. We got another 5,000. Where's our next 5,000? We got another 5,000 from the man who gave me my first job at an Arch Grants startup. We just had two founders back to back who were backed by Arch Grants over the last 10 years who had successful exits from their companies, who just donated $5,000 apiece to support the next generation of St. Louis entrepreneurs. Let's do a round of applause for that. Anyone else for $5,000 donations? Raise those paddles high. Lisa and I have a lot of lights glaring in our face, and it's hard to see you.
And FYI, $5,000 is $200,000 in revenue from Arch Grants companies.
Every $5,000
supports
$200,000 in revenue. Babe, we need to talk about our investment portfolio. We should get some money.
Oh, 401k?
The Arch Grants 401k here.
And also, guys, every $250 is a square or a diamond up here. So Gable's committed to wash one dish per extra square. So $5,000. Who wants to blow this out?
We're going to drop it down.
Oh, wow. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Woo!
Somebody, thank you so much. One more round of applause.
That guy wants. Woo! What? Do we
thank
have
you
one
so
more?
Much. We got woo! Another $5,000.
So another $5,000.
I want to do a round of applause for everyone who's helped support tonight. Anyone else for $5,000?
$5,000. We have a hard time seeing, so. Who wants Gabe to do the dishes?
All right. Who here will donate $2,500 to Arch Grants tonight? Please raise those pallets high. Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
We have another one.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for your generosity. I want to have one more round of applause for all the folks. We've got a lovely lady in beautiful pink blazer over here who just donated $2,500 to Arch Grants.
Woo! Thank you. Okay, so one more stat. Over $120 million in St. Louis wages were paid in the past decade via Arch Grants companies. So at $2,500, that is $22,500 in St. Louis wages back, right back into the community for $2,500.
Although the statistic everyone really cares about is how many more Arch Grants do we need to fund until it is a statistical probability that we'll produce at least one more Arch Grants marriage.
Oh.
anyone for $1,000? Let's see the paddles. Will anyone donate $1,000 tonight? Thank you so much for your generous gifts. We've got one. We've got two. We've got three. We've got four. We've got five.
Oh, my God. Over there. Over there.
We've got six. My arm is going to get tired here before you guys are done. All right. Anyone else for $1,000 to Arch Grants tonight? We've got another one. Thank you so much. Arch Grants has always had a tradition of asking their entrepreneurs to do this instead of hiring those professionals who sell cows at the county fair. And a lot of folks think that's counterintuitive, but the investors in the room know that entrepreneurs are actually quite practiced at asking for money. Do we have anyone else who will donate $1,000 tonight? Okay, we're getting into the home stretch, and I hope you're as excited as I am to talk to some of the wonderful folks from our community. In this tail end, we want to get into maximum participation. I would be so proud to leave this room tonight knowing that 90% of the people who came out to see the amazing things happening in our community ended up making some kind of donation tonight. So first, we want to start at $500. Will anyone raise your paddle to donate $500 before we go out, meet all of these founders, talk to wonderful folks in our community? $500.
$500.
Woo! $500. Woo! Thank you. Will anyone else donate $500 tonight?
Did you guys know that St. Louis is the number one city for St. Louis female entrepreneurs? Not just St. Louis. Nationwide female entrepreneurs. Are there some female investors in this room that's going to stand up for that? $500. Are there some male allies in this room that will stand up for that?
Anyone else for $500?
Are there someone that wants Gabe to do more dishes? Two for $500.
Let's fill in a few more of these diamonds. $250. Please raise those paddles for $250 donations.
Woo!
Thank you.
$250.
Thank you.
One more there.
Thank you.
One more there.
Thank
one
you.
More there. Woo!
Let's do a big round of applause for everyone who's donated so far. We've got another for $250
another one right here.
Over here.
You guys know you can double down.
$250.
One more here. Woohoo! Female investors, come on out.
When I was 23 years old and I was attending with Jonathan, I had just gotten my first job and was working for an Arch Grants startup. And that night, I was so excited seeing a side of my city that I'd never seen. I just left Silicon Valley and had no idea that the city I was coming back to was trying to create a future where I could build a career as an entrepreneur, where I could do things that folks had dreamed about on the West Coast, but do it here, where I have family, where I have that Midwestern humbleness in the people around me. And I donated $50 that night. I wasn't making a whole lot at the time, but it was an aspirational $50. So we want to close out, and if you're willing to donate any amount tonight, 10, 50, 100, please stand up, raise those paddles, and let's finish with some St. Louis pride from everything you've seen tonight. Stand up if you're willing to donate any amount to Arch Grants and this amazing community.
Yes! Thank you guys so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Please keep your paddles raised. And so I wanted to just let you guys know what every dollar matters and why every dollar matters. Every dollar is $40 in revenue, additional revenue for the region. It's $9 in St. Louis wages, and Arch Grants Companies brings in 45 times the dollar amount that you put in.
And folks, I want to do one more big round of applause for everyone who made a generous donation tonight. This is really personal for me and Lisa. We appreciate the support. We appreciate everything you've paid forward. I'm going to hand it over to Gabe Angieri. Thanks again.
So, Luke, thank you so much. Not an easy job.
Thank you.
Seriously, thank you. I think I will be washing some dishes tonight. Let's go there. I think I will be washing some dishes tonight, but only because you gave so much of yourselves, of your resources and your time. Thank you for being here. If you haven't had your paddle collected yet, please do give it to one of our volunteers or leave it at the concierge desk. We've got a great after party. Please stick around. Enjoy the night. Meet more entrepreneurs. Thank you so much.